across the globe by satellite. Join us for Welcome to Grace, where we'll discover together the distinctiveness of Paul's apostleship through the rightly divided word of truth. Now, join pastor and Bible teacher Kurt Christ as we explore the unsearchable riches of Christ.
Well, thank you folks for joining us once again, and welcome to Grace. We are studying the Epistle to the Philippians, Paul's handbook on joy, and our text for this study will be a return to two verses that we looked at in our previous study, but we want to spend a little more time here. I think we can't just skip over these without going over them thoroughly, so pardon the review in some instances, but I think it'll be worth it. We want to read verses 8 and 9 once again to get us underway. In Philippians chapter 3, verse 8, Paul writes, "Yea, doubtless, and I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord." That word excellency there, we could say, for the surpassing worth, for the surpassing worth of Jesus Christ my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things and do count them but dung that I may win Christ. That's Philippians 8. Philippians 9 says, "And be found in him," in Christ that is, "not having mine own righteousness, which is of the law, but that which is through the faith of Christ," Christ's faithfulness, "the righteousness which is of God by faith." So when we look at verse 8 there and we examine Paul's words, there's a lot of meat here that we need to glean out before we move on. You recall what Paul was doing. Paul was answering a group of folks in his day who were trying to earn their righteousness before God by way of their performance. They thought that God would measure their do's and don'ts, and they thought they were actually measuring up. God would consider them righteous, worthy of his attention, worthy of being in heaven. They were bragging. They were boasting about their achievements as though God could do nothing other than to declare them righteous because they deserved just such a declaration. So Paul, who's actually not a braggart, don't fall for that thinking, that suggestion that's been offered up that Paul was braggadocious, that he was bragging. Paul's coming down to their level here, in a sense, only to make his point. He's answering them in the way that they've come to him. So he's using their own reasoning, and he's going to use it against them here. He speaks to them on their level to make his point. In the previous section, to where we are today, Paul warned the saints in Philippi to be on guard. Remember, he said, watch out for, look out for, with an idea to avoid, to guard against, guard against those who would promote a righteousness through performance idea. Up in verse 2 is where Paul made his caution in Philippians chapter 3, verse 2, where he said, beware. Now, Bible scholars point out the significance of the fact that Paul uses three bewares here, not just one. So this is for emphasis. Beware of dogs. Beware of evil workers. Beware of the concision. Is it not interesting that the Gentiles had been considered dogs? Now you come to Paul speaking to the saints in Philippi, and it's the unbelieving Jews who are considered dogs. Beware of dogs. Beware of evil workers. Beware of the concision. For we are the circumcision which worship God in the Spirit and rejoice in Christ Jesus, and have no confidence in the flesh. Understand, there's been much misconception concerning this passage. Paul is not telling the saints in Philippi or the saints of any time in this age of grace, any place. He's not saying that body of Christ saints are nothing more than spiritual Israel here. He's simply drawing a contrast between those who were relying upon ritual for righteousness and those who place no confidence whatsoever in their flesh for right standing before God. You see, the concision, although it sounds like the word circumcision, the concision is a reference to those false teachers, those Judaizers, who thought that ritual, who thought that they could do something, perform something, and the ritual here was circumcision. They thought they could do something to give them brownie points, to gain them brownie points before God in heaven. So Paul's correcting that notion. We can say, and you'll see why in a little bit, he's flushing that notion away. Circumcision, apart from faith, and that's Paul's point here. Circumcision apart from faith is nothing more than concision. It's nothing more than mutilation. And there were those who were cutting their bodies in other ways as well. It wasn't just circumcision. Paul refers to them as the mutilation because there was a common thread with these folks. They thought that what they were doing, they thought that their ritual would earn them favor with God. If these evil workers, Paul calls them, wish to boast in their works, put pride in their performance, and that was the basis by which in their minds they could merit a right standing before God, Paul had more reason than any of them to boast. Paul wasn't boasting, but he's telling them, I have more reason to boast if that is the way God values righteousness, if he values it through our performance. So Paul, as I said, is simply reasoning with these folks on their level to make his point. You'll recall the listing he gave us in verses 5 and 6. Well, we'll rehearse that listing again. Paul lists seven things there that put him head and shoulders above any of the others when it came to fleshly merit. Let's review that list. In verse 5, Paul writes, circumcised the eighth day. Now, we could give him a title there. We could say Paul was an eighth dayer. And when we say Paul was an eighth dayer, we're talking about that issue of circumcision. He was not a Gentile, converted at age 20 or 30 or 40 or whatever, and then circumcised as a proselyte to Judaism. He was not a Gentile taking hold of Israel's covenant and being circumcised. He was born into a Jewish family. Abraham's blood flowed in his veins. So in effect, he's saying here, if you guys want to boast, I don't believe in it. He's saying, I see no value in it. Nothing can be gained by it. But if you insist upon boasting in righteousness before God that you think you deserve, that you think you've earned, you've merited, I'll get in the ring with any of you guys. That's basically what he's saying here. Because I can knock you guys out in the first round, and then he proceeds to deliver the first punch. For starters, when it comes to circumcision, I'm not a convert to this thing called Judaism. I'm not a Johnny come lately here. I'm an eighth dayer. I was circumcised as a baby. Of course, he didn't have any choice in that matter, did he? That wasn't his decision. Shows you what kind of parents he had and how devout they were in the covenant faith there. Just as Paul didn't have any choice in the next three fleshly attributes that he's going to put on the table before them. But if they thought that they could merit any favor before God through fleshly attribute, Paul had some of his own fleshly attributes to bring to the table. Of the stock, stock is a strange word there to me, literally race, of the race of Israel. Of the race of Israel. Did Paul have any choice in that matter? Could Paul make the decision that he was going to be of the race of Israel? No, once again, that was totally out of his control. But did the Judaizers not think that being of the race from Abraham, that would give them a measure of righteousness in the eyes of God Almighty? Certainly they did. Christ had to set them straight on that account, and he did so in Matthew chapter 3, verse 9, where Christ told those folks, "And think not to say within yourselves, we have Abraham to our father. For I say unto you that God is able of these stones to raise up children unto Abraham." So just the fact that they were of the physical lineage of Abraham didn't cut the mustard as far as their righteous standing with God was concerned. But remember,